Well, good morning. First of all, I'm going to download the files that we're going to use today. You have them in Edmodo. There is a post, the last post, which has three files to download. So let's download them. This one, and there is a third one. And these are the three scripts that we are going to use today to talk about logistic regression and overfitting in supervised learning. You remember what we saw on Monday? We were talking about supervised learning and logistic regression. With logistic regression, the problem that we have is one problem of classification. Our DV, our dependent variable, is not a quantitative one anymore. It's a qualitative one. For instance, gender, or in our example was classifying an email as ham or spam. That's what we want to classify. So our dependent variable, the one we want to predict, is a qualitative one. And the variables we have in order to predict the factors are either qualitative or quantitative. In our example, the qualitative variable was ham or spam, the kind of email. And we saw that, well, the idea is very similar, very close to linear regression, but there is a problem. If we used linear regression, what could happen with our DV? The problem is that in linear regression, the output, the DV, is unbounded. There are no limits, there are no bounds for the possible values of the DV. And which was the solution that we adopted? You remember? We decided to use a function which is called the sigmoid function, and this function maps real values from minus infinity to plus infinity into the range, the interval 0, 1. This is the sigmoid function, which is more or less something like this. It takes values from minus infinity to plus infinity and then maps them into the interval 0, 1. And the sigmoid function, if this is dx, and this is f of x, is 1 divided by 1 plus x minus x. Okay, so this is the idea, this is the sigmoid function, and we use it to map values from minus infinity to plus infinity into values from 0 to 1. So our final function, our model, is not a linear model anymore, because we plug a linear model into this sigmoid function and we get something like this. 1 divided 1 plus x, and here the exponent is minus alpha plus beta 1 x1 plus dots beta k xk. So what do we have here? We have our usual linear function. This is the same as linear regression. We have a linear combination of the factors, but we plug it into the sigmoid function in order to get a result which is between 0 and 1. And why is that? Why do we want numbers between 0 and 1? Yeah, because we are interpreting this value, this result that we get here, as the estimated probability of getting a 1. In our example, we defined that the dependent variable had two possible values, 1 for spam and 0 for ham. So if we define the DV like this way, when we estimate the values for alpha, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, and so on, we're going to get values here, which are going to be estimations of the probability of an email being spam. Okay, that's why we got numbers between 0 and 1. Okay, that's one thing we saw. And then we covered the cost function. Do you remember that? The cost function. In linear regression, the cost function is very, very easy. It's very simple. In linear regression, the cost function is this. Is the difference between reality and the estimation squared and added up for every observation. And that's what we call the residual sum of squares. If we follow the least squares criterion, okay? This is the idea. We want to minimize this. We minimize this, and then we get the best line of fit. But in logistic regression, things are not as simple. Do you remember what we did? Yeah, we used a logarithmic function. The logarithm is something like this. We have here the 1. So this is the, if this is the x, this is log of x. And we want this part of the logarithm, but we want it here. So this is the function minus logarithm of x. This was one of the functions that we used, and the other one was just the opposite, this one, which is minus logarithm of 1 minus x. And this function here, the one above, penalizes what? Small values or big values? That's the cost function. Here, the cost is big when the number is small. So this function penalizes small values. And this function here penalizes big values. So we combine these two functions together and got a cost function which implied logarithms and the sigmoid function, okay? A very long cost function with logarithms and so on. We wrote the other day in the whiteboard. I'm not going to write it today. And the problem is that in order to minimize this cost function, we can follow an analytic procedure as the one we follow with this function. This function is very simple to minimize, and there is an analytic way to minimize it. But with the new cost function, with the cost function for logistic regression, there is no easy way to minimize it analytically. We have to minimize it numerically, using, for instance, gradient descent or other procedures to minimize a function. But don't worry, because R is going to do it for us. And that's what we saw in the last session. Oh, we saw the last thing we saw was, what do we need to do? Sorry. With this procedure, we can separate, or we can classify things, objects, subjects, cases, when the DV has two possible values, 0 and 1. What do we do, or what do we have to do, if our DV has more than two possible values? For instance, 1, 2, 3. Do you remember? The procedure was called 1 versus all. And the idea is that if we want to classify, for instance, in classes 1, 2, and 3, we need to classify 1 versus 2 and 3, then 2 versus 1 and 3, and then 3 versus 1 and 2. And here, we're going to get a classifier, a second classifier, and a third classifier. And this classifier is going to give us the probability of being a 1, this is the probability of being a 2, this is the probability of being a 3, and we are going to classify the object into the class which has the highest probability. Okay? That's the procedure, which is called 1 versus all. There are other procedures to do this, but this is the simplest one, and I think it's the most used. Okay, questions about this?
found sometimes in the papers and the research papers that they combine between the probability model and the logic. So why do they use both of them?
Why using both of them? Probability and project and logit. What we're following here is the logit model. This is the logit. Probit uses a different function in order to plug the sigmoid function we talked about before, which turns numbers from minus infinity to plus infinity. This function, if you use this function, you are using the logit model. If you use a different function, then you're using the probit model. You could use both of them and compare the results. But depending on what the literature says, what previous studies say, you have to use one or the other. But hopefully you're not going to find big differences by using one or the other.
So you can use any of them?
Depending on what your literature says. Here we are following the logit procedure, but I told you the day before that the sigmoid function is not the only one that maps minus infinity to plus infinity into 0, 1. Pablo, who was there the previous day, asked me, can we use another function? And I answered yes, of course. Any function that maps values from minus infinity to plus infinity from here to 0, 1 is a possible function you could use. The sigmoid function is one of them and takes us to the logit model. But if you choose another one, you get other models. Okay. Any more questions? Morning? Well, now what we're going to do is to do this with R, of course. And the script that we need to use is not here, it was posted. Yeah, this is the one we need to use, logistic regression 2.r. so we are going to download it. And we are going to open it with R Studio. Windows no puede abrir este archivo. Okay. ¿Dónde estás? R Studio. Okay, and now file. File, open file. And escritorio. And here we have logistic regression 2.r. this is the file that we are going to follow. Okay, so this is an example about tumors. Okay, we have a set of patients. This is very used in medicine, for instance. We have a set of patients, a set of cases, set of people, a group of people. And we have information on two features, which are called X1 and X2. These features are about tumors. So we have measured the size of the tumor. The first feature, the X1, is the size. You can think of it about being centimeters, for instance. And we have a second factor, which is called X2, which is the age of the tumor. How long ago did it appear? Okay, that's the two. These are the two features that we have. Okay, zero. Zero is benign, one is dubbed, and two is malignant. So that's the information that we have. We enter data here in the first three, with the first three commands. We create three objects, x1, x2, and y, and that's what we have. The y is the dependent variable, and x1 and x2 are the independent variables or the factors that we're going to use to predict the class of the tumor. So let's select the first three commands and run them, and we're going to have three objects created here. And of course, there are numbers. Everything here is a number. Okay. And let's plot them. And we get this plot. Where is it? Here. Okay. The first thing that we notice here we have size, x1. Here we have age of the tumor. And the color is the DV. Okay, so what we see here is that black points tend to be in the lower left part. Okay, with this exception. Red points tend to be here to the right, and green points are in the middle, more or less. But one question: can we separate them? Can we separate the three groups with lines? Is it possible to draw a line? This is a question. Is it possible to draw a line that separates? Maybe you can see it better on your displays, on your screens. Is it possible to draw a line that separates black points from red points and green points? Is it possible to draw a line that separates red points from green and black points? What do you think? Yes or no? No, it's not possible. When this is not possible, we say that this set is not separable. We use this word. It's not linearly separable. So if we use a linear model, and logistic regression is a linear model, it is going to be impossible to separate them perfectly. We're going to have errors. We're going to have some cases that are not going to be well classified. So one thing we could think about is, okay, if using lines we can separate these sets into greens, reds, and blacks, what can we do? Let's use something different. Instead of lines, straight lines, we can use curves. Let's use curves. Maybe with curves we can separate these sets of points into greens on the one hand, reds on the other hand, and blacks on the third hand. Okay? Maybe using curves this will be possible. That is why we have created here a new set of features. Here, in this set of commands, with this set of commands, we are creating new features from the features that we have. We have just x1 and x2, remember, size and age. Size and age. But just from these two variables, this size and this age, we are creating new variables, new features, which of course are combinations of these features. For instance, we are creating a new feature which is called x1s, which is the square of x1. And why is that? Because if we use the square of x1, we are trying to, instead of using a straight line, using a curve. And the same thing happens if we compute x2 squared, that is x2x squared, and so on and so on and so on. So here, with this set of commands, we are creating new features from the features that we have. We don't have more data. The data we have is x1 and x2, size and age. But we are creating new features, which is going to allow us to have a more complex model, our model will be more complex because we are using more features, which are combinations of the data that we have, but using it with the intention of going beyond straight lines and using curves. That's what we want. Okay, so if we select this set of features, this set of commands, and we run them, nothing is going to happen. Well, yes, we're going to have more objects here, but R is going to remain quiet. It's going to say nothing, okay? We have created more features, which are, as you can see here, x1 squared, x2 squared, x1 times x2, x1 cube, x2 cube, x1 squared times x2, x2 squared times x1. And we could have created x1 exponent 4 and x1 exponent 5 or whatever we want. The more features we create, the more complex our model is going to be. Okay, do you see this? The more complex is the curve that we're going to try to use here to separate, because our goal is to separate black points from green points and red points. Okay, let's start easy. The first thing that we're going to do here is, first of all, our DV has three possible values, 0, 1, and 2. So we need to use this procedure, one versus all procedure. Okay, because we have three possible values, zeros, ones, and twos. So the first thing that we need to do is to separate zeros from ones and twos. Then we need to separate ones from zeros and twos, and then twos from zeros and ones. That's what we do here. Here, I commented this script. We want to train the first separator, which separates benigns versus everything else. Okay, this is the first separator. And this is a simple model. The first model that we're going to adjust is going to be a linear model. Linear, perfectly linear. We are not going to use these complex features we have just created. We will use them later. But from now, we're going to keep this as simple as possible. Here you can see it. This is the function that we need to use to adjust a logistic regression. As we saw the other day, for linear regression, the command was LM. Do you remember this? Linear model. Here we use another function which is called GLM. GLM means generalized linear model. This is the function that we use. So, we use this function, generalized linear model, with as factor y1, because the dv, as we entered it, is a number, and we need it to be a factor, so we turn numbers into factors. If you remember from the first day, if we want to turn a number into a factor, we can use this function as factor. This is the dv needs to be a factor. And then we have the tilde, as in the previous day, and the set of features that we're going to use to explain this dv. And in this case, there are size and age. Just a linear model. Okay? Perfect. So this command here is more or less the same as the day before when we said model 1, arrow, lm, y, tilde, x1 plus x2. It's more or less the same. But here we need to tell R the kind of function that we're using to map. Yeah.
Excuse me. Why take the...
Why what?
The line before.
This?
Above.
These two things?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm going to explain them.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. Wait a second. We need to tell R the function that we are going to use to map values from minus infinity to plus infinity into the 0, 1. We are going to use the sigmoid function, and to say this and to tell this to R, we need to say that the family is binomial. Okay, this is the way of saying to R that we are using this sigmoid function to classify. Okay, your question: why is that? Because now, here we have defined a variable, a DV, which is y, and this variable has zeros, twos, and ones. But in the first case, to follow the one versus all procedure, we have zeros, ones, and twos. We want to separate zeros from ones and twos. So, what have we done? Here we have created a new object, which is called y1. Y1 is a set of 15 zeros. This means repeat a zero 15 times. So, this yi is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 15 times. So we have 15 zeros. And then we take this object, the object we have just created with 15 zeros, and we select some of the positions. Which positions? The positions in which y equals 0. If you look here, the positions in which I equals 0 are the first one, the second one, the third one, the fourth one, and so on and so on. Okay? And there, in these positions, we're going to put a 1. So the object, which was 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 15 times, after we run these two commands, becomes 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 in these positions. And then 0, 0, 0, 0. So we have ones here for benign tumors, and we have zeros for everything else. You see it? That's what we get with these two commands. A set of 15 zeros, and then we substitute some of those zeros with ones, just in the positions of benign tumors, that are the tumors that we want to separate from everything else. So we have one benign, zero non-benign, which can be dubbed or malignant. Yes? And now that's the object that we use to classify. We use y1. Not y, but y1. Here. Okay? Let's do that. So we take this and we run it. And we get nothing, because R has done what we have asked it to do. He has adjusted this model, and all the information is now into a new, is inside the new object we have just created, which is called model 1. So if we want to know what has happened, we need to look into this object, which is called model 1. Okay, and I think the best idea here is to draw things. So we're going to draw. First, I'm going to show you the plot, and then I will explain you the commands that we have there. So let's take this set of commands, and let's run them, and let's see what we get. You get something like this? Something like this? Okay. Have a look at the plot you get and try to understand what's there. We have a line, which is the separator. This is the separator. And we have a, I don't know how to say that in English, un degradado, ¿cómo se dice? How do you say that?
Gradient.
A gradient, okay, thank you, thank you. Gradient, yeah. Here we have a dark zone, and here we have a light zone, and this is the separator. So, the idea is that if a point is in this area to the left, on the lower left part of the plot, then this is classified as benign, and if it's in this part here, it's classified as non-benign. And the intensity of the gray color measures the non-benign quality of the tumor. Okay? So if it's here, well, it's almost sure it's a benign tumor. If it's here, we're almost sure it's not a benign tumor. Okay? So we might say that the bigger the size and the bigger the age, the higher the probability of the tumor non being benign, which sounds quite logical. You see it? And here we have the classifier. This is the frontier, the point, the threshold, where we say, OK, if it's here, benign. If it's not here, then non-benign. But we have some problems, because, for instance, there are some mistakes, some errors. Are there any mistakes here? Yes, at least we have here one mistake, which is classified as benign, because it's in the lower left part. It's classified as benign, and it is adapt. So we have a problem here, and we have another problem here, because this is a, really, it is a benign tumor. We have analyzed it, and we know that it is a benign tumor, but it's classified as non-benign, because it's this part. You see this? So our classifier is not perfect. It's not perfect. If we used curves, maybe we will get a better classifier and we'll manage to exclude this thing and include this thing. With a curve, it's very easy. Something like this, and then excluding this and including this. But with a straight line, it's not possible. Okay. Now, let's try to explain this set of commands that we have here. Well, the first thing that we do here is use this command dev new. It just prepares a new window for a new plot. That means that we want to plot something new without deleting the previous plot. A new device. We want a new device for plotting. And then we say what we want to plot. We want to plot x1 and x2. So we plot the points size versus age of the tumor with no color and nothing else. Okay, then we create two new objects, which are called x and z, x and z. And these values, these objects, x and z, are a set of numbers. There are some numbers, which goes, this set of numbers, goes from the minimum value of x1 to the maximum value of x1, and has a length of 100. So we have 100 numbers from the minimum to the maximum. With a uniformly distributed. Okay, that's to create a grid. We want to create a grid. We want to create a grid to get the gradient, this gradient we get here. So we're creating a grid with 100 numbers from the minimum value of x1 to the maximum value of x1. And the same thing with x2. We create a new object, z, with 100 numbers from the minimum value of x2 to the maximum value of x2. That's what we get. And then, with this command, which is called expand grid xz, we combine this. This is the Cartesian product of this one and this one. So we took every point from x and every point from z and combined them in order to get all the possible couples of numbers, one from here and one from here. So we are getting, with this expand grid xz, we are referring to 100 times 100, 10,000 points that are here. This first point, the second point, the third point, and so on and so on and so on. So we have a grid. We have a grid. And this grid, which is called grid, with the name grid, very original name, we have this name grid, just represents the 10,000 different positions that we have established here in this graph. Okay? If, for instance, here we have decided to get an object whose length was 200 and here 200, this grid would have been 200 times 200, 40,000 points. You understand this? Perfect. And why do we want this? Because we want to use our model, the model that we have just adjusted, which is called model 1, this model that we have here, with this grid that we have just created, in order to get the value that our model predicts for each and every one of the points that we have there. Because the color of the gradient is based on model 1. Model 1 says, okay, what happens if we are at this point here? Which is the probability of being benign if we are just at this point here? Which is point number, I don't know how much, and I don't know how much. Well, probability is 0.3. Then I'm going to draw a point here. I'm going to draw a point with a color which is quite dark. That's the idea. So we use the grid we have just created and the model we have just estimated here to predict the probability of a tumor being there of being benign in this case. You understand? That's how we get this gradient. That's why points here are light and why points here are dark. Because we are using this grid and we're predicting for each point what's going to happen. Okay. Then we plot the grid with this function here, image, and then with this contour we draw the separator that separates probabilities bigger than 0.5 from probabilities lower than 0.5. So if a tumor is just here on the line, then the probability of it being benign is 0.5. If it's here, it's bigger than 0.5. If it's here, it's lower than 0.5. Okay? And that's it. And finally, we plot again the points with the color that differentiates them to see if they are benign, malignant, or dubbed. And I use Y plus 1 because color number 0, which is what we have here, is white and we can see it very well. Or black, I don't know. Okay? You see? More or less the set of commands. I don't want you to understand everything we do here. I want you to understand more or less the meaning of these commands. More or less. To see that this is not magic. Well, we have done the first thing. What else? Which is the second step? We have separated benigns from everything else. Now we want to separate dubs from everything else. So, what do we need to do? So now if we take this set of commands and we run them, we're going to get the second separator, which is a vertical one. Where are dabs? Dabs are here. Here, here, and here. So again, the probability of being a dabs is bigger if you are to the left, and it's smaller if we are to the right. In this case. Okay. Here we have no errors, I think. I don't see it very well. But I think we have no errors because the three green points are here. Now I'm not sure if dabs are green ones or red ones. I'm not sure. But in any case, we have separated, and this is the best linear separator that we can get in order to separate dabs from everything else. Okay? And now the third one. The third one that's going to separate malignant versus everything else.
And the color change.
Sorry?
The color of the.
Yeah?
Now it's the white in the other corner.
Yeah, that's what that's why I was wondering if reds are dabs. Because I think that as it's programmed, that is coded, then a light color means a big probability of being dabbed. So as I saw this graph here, I tend to think that these are dabs and these are not dabs. And this separator is separating these three points and has some mistakes, some errors here and here. That's what I think. And that maybe the green points are the malignant tumors. We could check this if we know the codes of the color codes. Or just looking here. Let's see it. Wait a second. Let's check this. Yeah, twos are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Sorry, but I want to check this. Dabs are here. So for instance, 4, 6 is a dab. Where is 4, 6? Sorry, 6, 4. 6, 4 is a dab. Okay. 6, 4, the last point is in point 6, 6, 4 is this one here. And it is a dab. So red points are dabs. And green points are malignant tumors. Okay, so you are right. The separator is separating dabs, red points, from everything else. And it has some errors. It has some errors. One here and one here. Of course, if we used a curve, we could do something like this. No problem. And we wouldn't make mistakes, but with a line it's not possible. So this is the best separator to separate, sorry, it's the best linear separator to separate red points, dabs, from everything else. Thank you. I was suspicious, but and now the third one. Now our goal is to separate green points from everything else. So again, good news, because we just need to copy and paste, change a few things, but just a few things. Now we are going to have Y3, which creates an object with 15 zeros, and we substitute malignant tumors with ones. So here we are going to separate malignant from everything else, green points from everything else. And we follow the same procedure as before. We run. And that's what we get. Yeah, that's what we get. This is the separator. And as before, a light color means a bigger probability of being malignant. So, where is the light color? The light color is here. So the bigger the size and the bigger the age, the higher the probability of being malignant. And the dark color is here. The lower the age and the lower the size, the higher the probability of not being malignant. Okay? So that's what we get. And again, if we want to separate greens from everything else, we have some mistakes, because this is well classified, this point here is well classified, this point is also well classified, but this point here isn't, and this point isn't well classified. Okay, so we have some mistakes. Okay, now let's combine everything. We have trained, or we have estimated three models, model 1, model 2, and model 3. Model 1 gives us the probability for every tumor of being benign. Model 2 of being adapt, and model 3 of being malignant. And what we need to do is to find the highest probability. And this is the class we are going to classify the tumor into. That's what we do here. We cbind. Cbind, this command, takes three columns, well, three or four or some columns, and puts them together. So we're going to get model 1 fitted, model 2 fitted, and model 3 fitted. This model 1, model 2, and model 3 fitted, these functions, give us the probability of being benign, adapt, and malignant. And we're going to combine them. Let's run this one first. And that's what we get. For the first tumor, this is the first one. These are the probabilities. The probability of benign, 0.97. The probability of adapt, 0.07. Probability of malignant, 0.05. So it's going to be classified as benign. Here is the highest probability. One thing, this plus this plus this is not one. It doesn't need to be one, because we have three different models and there are probabilities. We know that these are the three possibilities that we have, and they should add up to one, but they don't. So we just compute them and take the highest probability. So this is going to be classified as benign, and it is really a benign tumor. So, okay. The second one is also a benign tumor, and the highest probability is here. So it's going to be classified as benign. It's okay. The third one, here there is more doubt, because the probabilities, this one, benign and doubt, are very similar. Anyway, this is the highest, so it's going to be classified as benign, and it's okay. The fourth one is going to be classified as benign, and it's benign, so it's okay. The fifth one is going to be classified as malignant, because the highest probability is here, and it is benign, so we have a mistake. But this is good news. This is good news. You have a malignant tumor, and that's not true, so no problem. Well, next one is going to be classified as benign, and it's really malignant. Here we have a big problem. This is a really big problem. Oh, don't worry, your tumor is benign, and then it isn't. That's a very big problem. Okay? The next one is going to be classified as benign again, and it's malignant. And so on and so on and so on. Okay? Here we check for the highest probability, and we compare the highest probability with the real quality of the tumor. Or we could use the following command, which automatically looks for the maximum sorry, where is it? Here. Here, looks for the column with the maximum value. This command here, computes, tells us which is the column which has the maximum probability. Okay? So if we run the last command, well, and then we have here this minus one, sorry, this minus one here, because columns are 1, 2, and 3, and two more qualities are 0, 1, and 2. So in order for comparison, we take this minus one, we run, and that's what we get. The first one is a problem here. It's classified as malignant and it is benign. Oh, not big deal. Here we have a big problem. It's classified as benign and it's really malignant. Benign and it's really malignant. Doubt and it's really malignant. Malignant, 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 malignant. And then we have here benign and it's a doubt. Benign, 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 sorry. Doubt, 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 doubt. Malignant is a doubt. And the last one, doubt, doubt. So we have some classification errors. Okay. Questions? Now we are going to repeat the same procedure, much faster, but not with lines, but curves. Easy, see? We created a set of new features. Do you remember this set of features that we created here? Combining x1 and x2, squaring them, and so on and so on, and multiplying them. We're going to use this set of features in order to get more complex models. These more complex models are going to fit better to the data that we have, because we're going to use curves, and if we use curves, then we are going to be able to classify things better than if we are limited to using curves, using straight lines. You understand this? Usually, they are quite arbitrary. Usually, what you do is take what you have and square them. And this is going to give you some complexity in your model. Then, if it's not enough, then you use the cubes, so exponent 3. And with exponent 3, you have x1 exponent 3, x2 exponent 3, and x1 squared times x2 or x1 times x2 squared. Then you use exponent 4, grade 4. And with grade 4 you have x1, 4, x2, 4, or x1, 3 times x2, x1 squared times x2 squared, and so on and so on. And the bigger the number of features, the more complex the model is going to be. And the better, between quotes, is going to be the fit that you're going to get. And if it gets very good, or if the fit is too good is like an oxymoron, but here, too good means something in data analysis. You are overfitting your data, and we talk about this later, okay? But here, let's use just this set of features that we have arbitrarily decided to use. Here we have squares and cubes, and let's see what happens. So now, here we have a second part, which is complex models. And it's the same as before. The difference is that now, instead of having just x1 and x2 here as factors to explain the kind of tumor we have the whole set of features, x1, x2, x1 squared, x2 squared, x1 times x2, and so on and so on and so on and so on. We're going to use a bigger set of features, which is going to allow us to have a more complex model. Let's just take this thing, the first separator. We want to separate in the first separator, we want to separate benigns from everything else. You remember benigns are black points, so we want to separate black points from everything else. Let's run this set of commands. And let's see what happens. That's what happens. You get the same results? That's what we get. So again, we have this gradient. The gradient means that the lighter the color, the higher the probability of being benign. So we have light colors over here and also over here. And we have dark colors over there. And we have the zero, which is just here. This is the frontier. And we have two zones, here and here. What does that mean? What points, which points are going to be classified as benign tumors? Points here, under this curve, are going to be classified as benign. And as I told you before, you laughed at what I said, but I told you before, if we had a curve here, we could do something like this in order to exclude a point which is here, and in order to include a point which is here. And that's what we get. This curve moves like this in order to exclude this point and in order to include this point. You see that? That's because we have a more complex model, and this more complex model is much more flexible. And as it is more flexible, it can adapt to the data we have much better. That's what is happening here. The model is as flexible, so flexible, that it can adapt, it can move to exclude this point and to include this point. And then here, we have a zone, which means that if we had a tumor here, would be classified as benign also, and points over here, here, are going to be classified as non-benigns. This zone here is an artifact. It makes no sense, because here there is nothing. So it makes no sense. The thing is that in order for this curve to move like this, and with this set of features that we have used, we need this zone here to be a benign zone also. But the idea here is, these points are benign, these points here are benign, and these points here are malignant. Sorry, are non-benign, malignant or DAPTs. Do you see it? Okay. Let's look at the second separator. The second one was separating DAPTs from everything else. And remember, DAPTs are red points. It's going to be difficult because we have red points almost everywhere. But let's see what happens. Let's train the second separator. Let's see what can we do with our more complex model. And as a consequence of being more complex, more flexible model. Let's run this set of commands. And that's what we get. Look at this. This is incredible. Yeah, because what we have here, again, is, remember, the lighter the color, the bigger the probability of being a DAPT. So we have light color here. We have dark color over here. And again, we have light color here. Maybe on your screens you can see it better. But here, it's darker on this intermediate zone. Here is lighter, and here it is also lighter. And in any case, we have the zero here, this frontier, which means that these are classified as one thing and this as another thing. So, what does that mean? Which points are going to be classified as DAPTs? The points here, everything which is to the right part of this curve, so it's including this thing and this thing and this point. So the curve here moves to include this, this, and this, and exclude this, 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 and this, and this, and then magically something appears here that includes as that this one and this one. You see this? So we have a more complex model, and this more complex model is managing to adapt to the data as well as to make no mistakes. With a linear separator, that was impossible. But with this more complex separator, we are getting these results. Everything here is well classified, I think. Yeah. How do you feel?
The red dot is, I'm sorry, the black dot is on the whole shape.
Yeah, this is just in the limit. I don't know. How is
the black one on top, is that considered?
The one on the top.
Yeah.
No, this is not a point. This is a zero. This is zero. This is number zero. That means, yeah, and you have another zero here. That's the frontier, and the frontier has a value which is zero. Because the function there takes the value zero, and it's not a point. This is not a point. This is a number zero. If you look at it carefully, you're going to see that it's different from these points, from this point, which is a point, a real point. This is a zero. Okay, so let's see what happens with the third one. The third one, which tries to separate malignants, which are green points, from everything else. And remember, separating green points looks a challenge, because green points are in the middle, and we couldn't separate them with a straight line. Let's see what happens with curves. Let's see what happens. We train the third separator. And plot it. And that's what we get. Poof, that's what we get. So we have a light zone. Definitely here, this is a light zone. So these points here have a very high probability of being malignant, which are green points, remember? Green points are malignant. So this one is well classified. This one is well classified. And this one here is also well classified. See the curve? The curve moves in order to include this point which is here, and to include this point which is here, and almost or exclude this point which has to be excluded. And then, as we have a couple of tumors which are here and here, and these tumors are malignant, then appears a new zone here with a lighter gradient. So again, these two points are correctly classified as malignant. And this point here, and this one here, and this one here, and this one here, and this one, and this one, and this one, are correctly classified as non-malignant. You see this? So, the general idea, or the main message, is what happens if we use straight lines? What happens if we use a simple model? If we use a simple model, this simple model is not going to adapt to our data as good as a more complex model. If we use a more complex model, like this one with curves, then this more complex model is able to adapt to the data almost perfectly. And you might say, okay, then the message is we should always use a complex model. Because if we want our model to adapt to the data, let's use a more complex model and we will get a better fit. And that's not true. That's not true. And that's what I want you to explain in the second part of the class. Okay, to finish with this, let's see what happens in general. Let's compute the probability for these complex models of being benign malignants and tumors, and DABs. And let's see how many mistakes, how many errors we have. Okay, That's what happens. The probabilities are not important. What we want is the final result, and here is the final result. Let's see what happens with our benign tumors. These are the benign tumors, the really benign tumors. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and that's it. The first five are benign tumors, and they are classified as benign, and one of them is incorrectly classified as adapt. Well, not too bad. Let's see what happens with our malignant tumors. These are malignant tumors, really malignant tumors, and they are classified as malignant, 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 and one DAPT. Okay, not too bad. And then let's see what happens with our DAPTs. DAPT, 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 classified as DAPT, 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 and one as benign. So our more complex model fits much better than the simple model that we used before. You see this? Questions? No questions. Okay. Let's forget this one. This one. Now let's open the script, which is called I want to change this. Let's try another thing. Let's open this script. Overfitting in regression.r. This one. Do you have this? Overfitting in regression? No? It is here on Edmodo. Yeah. In the post that I sent yesterday, you can see two files. But there are three files, so it's the third one. Well, this is a short script, and again we're going to talk about linear regression. We're going to forget for a while about logistic regression. We're going to talk about linear regression again, and I want you to show this idea that I mentioned just a moment ago. The idea of the better the fit, the happier I am, is not true. If the fit is too good, this is bad news. The fit has to be just right. Not overfit, not underfit, just fit. Because overfitting, that's what we are going to talk about right now, means that you are fitting the noise of your data. Every data set has some signal. The signal is the real relationship between the variables that you are analyzing. This is the signal, and every data has some noise. Noise is random noise. Variation that is not caused by the variables that you have here or the real relationship between them, but because of other factors. And data has signal and has noise. And of course, you want to fit signal, but you don't want to fit noise. If you fit noise, you are overfitting. And that's what happens when you have a model which is too complex, because a model which is too complex tends to fit signal and also noise. It's like when you are on a station, on a train station, and there is something playing the violin, and then the train comes. You want to hear the violin. You don't want to hear the train. Well, you want to take the train, but you want to listen to the violin, and you have to make effort to listen just to the violin and forget about the noise of the train coming into the station. That's what we need to do. We need our model to listen to the violin and forget about the train. Okay? Let's see what happens, or what could happen. Here we are going to use a data set which is inside R. R has some data sets which are there, that which we can use. And one of them is called cars. And it has, this data set has information, has data on two variables, two features, which are speed and distance. We have a set of cars, and we have measured the speed at which the car is moving and the distance it needs to stop. And we know that the bigger, the higher the speed, the higher the distance you need to stop the car. So there is a linear relation, well, there is a positive relation between speed and distance. Okay, so we're going to use this data set in order to show what happens if we overfit the data. Okay, so first of all, as we're going to select random numbers, we're going to select random numbers because, as you're going to see later, we're going to divide this data set into parts. We're going to use the same seed. You know, computers don't generate real random numbers. They generate pseudo-random numbers. They're not really random numbers. And in order for everyone here to get the same results, we're going to use the same seed. The same seed for generating random numbers. So I have decided that the seed that we're going to use is 1, 2, 3. This is just the goal of this, of setting this seed, is for everyone here getting the same results. If we don't set the same seed, everyone would get different results. We'll get different results. So let's use this seed, 1, 2, 3. Nothing is going to happen. Then we tell R that we want to use this data set, which is called cars, and then it appears here, cars, and we know that we're going to use this data set, which is called cars, and the first thing that we're going to do is to divide this data set into parts. One which is going to be called training, and one which is going to be called test. Okay? So, it's something like this. We have our set of 50 cars, and we're going to randomly assign 30 of them to training and 20 of them to test. What does that mean? That means that in order to estimate our model, in order to find the relationship between distance and speed, or better, between speed and distance, we are just going to use these 30 cars. And we're going to forget about these 20 cars. We're going to get a model. And then we are going to use these 20 cars, which we have not used to estimate the equation, in order to measure the quality of what we have. Okay? You understand this? So, the training test is the part of the data set that we use to estimate the model, and the test set is the part of the data set that we use to measure the quality of the model that we have. And usually, it's 2/3 and 1/3, usually. More or less, 30 and 20. So in order to do that, we use these commands here. With this first command, we are asking R to select 30 different numbers from numbers from 1 to 50. So we're going to get 30 numbers, which can be 2, 7, 8, 5. We are just selecting a subset of these 50 cars in order to create the training sample. Okay, so if we run this first command and then we write here muestra.training, we get this. Which cars are going to be in the training sample? Car number 15, 39, 20, 42, 44, 3, 24, and so on and so on and so on. These cars are going to be in the training sample. You get the same results. That's because we are using the same seed. If we used different seeds, we would get different results. But as we are using the same seed, you should get the same results. Okay? So these are just the indices for the cars which are going to be in the training sample. Okay? And now, once we have the indices, sorry, what happens? Nothing. Okay. Once we have the indices, we take the data set cars and we select these indices that we have here and put them in cars.training. And the indices that are not here, that's why we have a minus here, are put into cars.test. So we have divided cars in two parts, cars test and cars training. Cars test is the part which is going to be used for the test, and cars training, the part that we are going to use to estimate the model. You see this? Okay. And now we adjust model number one, modelo uno, modelo one. This is a linear model. We want to estimate distance with speed, and the data that we are going to use is just cars.training. So we are using the data set which is called cars training. Just these 30 cars here. Okay? And then we're going to predict with this modelo 1, with this model that we have just estimated, we're going to predict the estimations for distance, but not for training, but for the data set that we're going to use to estimate the quality of what we have done. So the idea is, we estimate the models with training, and then we use this model with the data here, with the data in the test part, and finally we compute what? What's this? This is the sum of the squares of the differences between reality, cars test dist reality, and what our model tells us. So we are measuring the residual sum of squares, but not here, but here. Do you understand the procedure? Again, we use this model, sorry, this data set to estimate. And then, with this model we have just estimated with the training set, we measure the residual sum of squares here. You see this? Perfect. That's what we do with this set of commands. So, let's run from the beginning. And this is what we get. With this model, I'm going to write it down here. With this model, which is very, very simple, because it just has speed, but linearly, to estimate distance, we get a residual sum of squares, which is 5,294, with just speed. Now, the idea is, if I used a more complex model with dist and, for instance, the squared speed, that is, if I include the possibility of this model having a curve, then a curve is going to adapt better to the data we have than a straight line. So, what should happen? The residual sum of squares should be, if the model adapts better, if it fits better, we should get a residual sum of squares which is smaller. Well, that's true if what we're using is a training set and then we are measuring the residual sum of squares in the training set. But if we are using a training set to estimate the model and then we are using a different set to measure the quality of the model, it might happen that the model has overfitted this data, and when new data appears, then this data is not well predicted. It might happen. And this would result in a bigger residual sum of squares. Okay. Let's see what happens with the third model. Here, we have a more complex model. We are going to forget the second one because... No, okay. Let's look at the second one. The second model. We have the second model here, model number 2. And we have linear model. We want to estimate distance, and we have two features, which are speed and the square of speed. This is clearly a more complex model. Here we have the possibility of having a curve, a quadratic curve. So it's a more flexible model. It should adapt better, and it's going to adapt better to the training sample. But let's compute what happens when we compute the residual sum of squares for the test sample. Let's see what happens. Oh, gloop. That's the value we get. So, if we use a more complex model, which has a speed and the speed squared, we get a residual sum of squares for the test sample, which is 5,834. What does that mean? What's happening with our more complex model? It's worse. It's worse, because really what happens is that probably the relationship between distance and speed is really a linear relationship. It's really a linear relationship. So when we give the model the possibility of adapting to the data better than what the real relationship is, that is, when we give the model the probability of being a curve, okay, it is a curve, but this curve adapts too much to the training data. It's overfitting the training data. So when overfitting means that it's too close, relies too much on this data. So when new data appears, which has not been studied by our model, then our model doesn't understand what's happening there. What's that? The points are not close to the prediction, but far away from the prediction. That's what happens. So we get a worse residual sum of squares. And just to end up with this part, let's try to do things even worse. Let's try to use an even more complex model. This one. With this third model, the last one, we have distance, and we want to estimate distance with speed, the square of speed, and the cube of speed. So it is a cubic line. It's much more flexible than a quadratic line. Much more flexible than a line, than a straight line. It's a curve which is much more complex, much more flexible. So it's going to adapt to the training data even better. So if we were overfitting, then now we're going to overfit dramatically. Let's see what happens. That's the value we get. That's the residual sum of squares for the test sample. So here we see that our more complex model, which is fitting the data here much better than the previous ones, sure, the residual sum of squares for the training sample is smaller than for the previous models, no doubt, because it's more complex and it can adapt to the data much better. That's a very poor job when it tries to adapt to this data here. The residual sum of squares with speed. Speed squared. And the speed to the cube, this is a 2, is 6,873. So, if you had to choose, which model would you choose? The first one, because the first one is the model which has the smallest residual sum of squares for the test sample, and that's the criterion that we need to use. We don't want our model to minimize the residual sum of squares for the data that we have used to estimate the model. Because if we follow this approach, we will always take the most complex model. The more complex the model, the better the fit, no doubt. The better the fit for the training sample. But when you take this model and use it with new data, what happens then? That's what we need to check. So keep this in mind. Never, 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 never follow the idea of minimizing the residual sum of squares for the training sample. No. Always, always, always follow the following approach. Minimize the residual sum of squares for the test sample, which is a set of data that the model has not used in order to estimate the parameters that you need to estimate. It's new data. Completely new data. Of course, we can do this if we have a lot of data. Usually we have few points and we don't want to use some of them just to test. Then there are other ways to try to do this, like bootstrapping and these kind of things. But this is a better approach. Just keep one part of the data set just to test. It is always a good idea. Okay, questions?
What is the capital I?
The capital I here. Well, this capital I here is the identity function, which means that R computes speed to the cube and then creates a new object which is the same. There is a problem here. If we use speed to the cube, R understands that we want to use speed to the square and a speed cube. And in order to avoid this, we use this I there. It's just a syntax problem. Well, now we are going to break, as always, for 20 minutes more or less, and then we are going to see KNN. KNN is a K nearest neighbors procedure, which is going to help us understand better the idea of overfitting. Okay? Perfect. Well, I'm going to explain now KNN, K nearest neighbors, just in 15 minutes. It's very easy to explain. And then to understand overfitting, we are going to use KNN. KNN is a very old technique. It's very simple, but I think it's the best one to understand how overfitting works. So what happens when we overfit? So we're going to explain in just 15 minutes what KNN is, how it works, and then we're going to follow on a script in R in which we're going to visually understand what overfitting means. Because there's going to be a parameter that we're going to move. This parameter, this is a number we can choose. And depending on the value, the fit is going to be better or worse. But the fitting to the training sample. And we're going to see that when we move this parameter to the left, to lower values, to the left from your side, when we move it to the left, to lower values, we're going to get an incredible fit for the training sample. The classifier is going to do whatever is necessary to do in order to feed the data. But then we're going to use this classifier with a sample test, and with a test set, and we're going to realize that that's absolute nonsense. So I think that it's a very good idea to explain KNN in order just to visualize this thing. Okay, so what's KNN? KNN means K nearest neighbors. KNN
means K nearest neighbors. So the idea is that if, for instance, as we had before, a data set with tumors, and we had the size of the tumor and the age of the tumor, and we have here some tumors which are benigns and some tumors which are malignant over here, and we have to classify a new tumor. For instance, let's suppose that we have a new patient and we measure the size of the tumor and the age of this tumor, and it's, for instance, here, at this point, the question is this a malignant tumor or is this a benign tumor? Well, the answer, if we follow this procedure, is let's look at the K nearest neighbors and let's decide on the quality of this tumor just by a majority rule. For instance, if K equals 5, then we're going to look at the 5 nearest neighbors. Which are the 5 nearest neighbors? This one, I don't know. this one, and this one, maybe. Or maybe this one, I don't know. Well, let's draw this one here. Let's suppose that these are the 5 nearest neighbors. So, as these are the 5 nearest neighbors, we follow a majority rule, and then the decision is, this is going to be a malignant tumor. It's going to be classified as a malignant tumor. And why is that? Because its neighbors are malignant. If we follow a majority rule, the neighbors of this tumor, which is here, are malignant. So let's define this, let's classify this as a malignant tumor. This is the idea behind KNN. Of course, we always use, if we are classifying, we always use odd numbers for K in order to avoid draws, in order to avoid having 2 and 2 or 3 and 3. So we use 3 nearest neighbors, 5 nearest neighbors, 7 nearest neighbors, 11, 13, but never 12, 10, 8, 6, 4, 2. Okay? And of course, the limit is using 1 nearest neighbor. Let's look at the nearest point. If we follow 1 nearest neighbor, then what we do is just look at the nearest neighbor. In this case, if it's here, it's going to be benign. If it's here, it's going to be malignant, and so on and so on. Okay? That's the idea. Let's think for a minute. What happens if we define K to be the sample size? Let's go to one bound and then the other. If K equals 1, if K equals 1, which is the lowest possible value for K, then we just look at where the point is and which is the nearest neighbor. What happens if we define K to be the biggest possible value, which is the total sample size? In this case, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. We have 11 points. What happens if we define K to be 11? This cluster is going to have just one point. I don't understand. What do you mean?
So, the K defines how many groups?
No. This is not K means. Okay. K defines, this is KNN. KNN. This means, this K defines how many points, how many neighbors you consider. So, if K equals 1, you just consider one neighbor, the nearest one. If K equals 11, in this case, you're going to consider every point. So if we consider every point in our data set, what happens? Yeah, we are going to follow a majority rule. It doesn't matter where the new tumor is. If it's here, it's going to be, if k equals 11, it's going to be malignant, because we have 6 malignant and 5 benign. It's going to be malignant. If it's here, it's going to be malignant. If it's here, it's going to be malignant, 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 malignant. So if k equals 11, then the position of the point is completely irrelevant. The only thing which is relevant is which is the proportion of malignants and benigns. So if k is very big, we don't rely on the data we have. If k equals 1, we are trusting, we are relying too much on the data. So this is going to be the parameter that we can use to fit better or worse. The smaller the value, the smaller the value for k, the better the fit to the training sample. The more we're relying on the data, the bigger the number, the less we are relying on the data. You see this? We don't rely on the position of the points. We just, if k is very big, we don't care where this is, where this is. We don't care. We just care how many malignant tumors we have, how many benign tumors we have. So we are not relying on the data, on where the points are, but on the composition of the sample. OK, this is the idea. Yeah, you have one question.
It would be a point with the number of the cases are the same.
Yeah.
We can decide.
Yeah. Yeah.
What we can do.
That's the idea. That's what I want you to understand. If k is too small, that's not good, because you are overfitting. If k is too big, that's not good, because you are underfitting. So you have to find the right value for k, which doesn't overfit and doesn't underfit. Which is this value? We'll see. We'll see. But choosing too low a value means that you're overfitting. Using too high a value means that you are underfitting. And we are going to visually understand it. Never, because you are never going to use k equals 6.
Okay. No, for example.
No, you're always going to use odd numbers, 7, 5, so no draws, never. Okay. Never. We are going to use 1, 3, 5, 7 in order to avoid this problem. Because if we have this problem, yeah, if we have 3 and 3, then what's that? Well, we have to toss a coin and see what. We can apply this idea also to linear regression. We could say, okay, this KNN idea. Let's think for a minute on a situation like this. We have the size of the house, and we want to predict the price. And we have one house which is here, another one which is here, another one here, 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 and then suddenly, a new house appears, and we want to predict the price for this house. And this new house is here. Well, here. It's not here, it's here, because we know the size, we don't know the price. It's here. What can we do? For instance, if k equals 3. If k equals 3, we could say, let's consider the three houses which are the nearest neighbors of this house according to size. And these three houses are this one, and this one. These three houses. Well, let's look at the prices of these three houses. And let's estimate the price of the new house, which is here, as the average value of this one, and this one. This is the idea of KNN for regression, if k equals 3. Again, if we take k equals 1, what's going to happen? We're just going to look at the nearest house. So if our new house is here, then the nearest house, according to size, is this one. So we are going to assign to this house the price of this house. What happens if k equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6? If k equals 6, in this case, let's put another one. If k equals 7, what happens if k equals 7? What's going to be the estimated price for a house which is here? No. Here we are following 7 nearest neighbors. Which are the 7 nearest neighbors of this house? The whole set. So we're going to consider the average price for the 7 houses that we have. And what happens if the new house is here? Well, the estimation is going to be the same. So again, if k is too big, then our estimation is not going to change according to the size of the house. It's going to be the same no matter what the size of the house is. If k equals 1, then we're going to just rely on this point. So again, if k is very small, we're going to overfit, rely too much on the data we have. If k is very big, then we're going to forget about where the data is and just compute the average, which is the same idea as here. We here have computed the average. The average tumor here, average between quotes, is malignant. The average house here has a price, which is the average price. So if k is very big, then we use the average. Here we use the average. Okay, we're going to see now a script. We're going to review a script, an R script, with this situation, a classification problem. Okay, and let's see what we have. The script is called k nearest neighbors. Well, going to. So file, open file. I know you see nothing. Eh? Wait a second. Any question on how KNN works? I think it's very easy to understand. The idea of looking at the k nearest neighbors and use these values to estimate. Well, everyone has this script, has opened the script, which is called k nearest neighbors. That's the script that we're going to follow. And first of all, as before, we're going to generate some random data. We're going to generate some random data. And in order to get the same results, we're going to set the seed again to 1, 2, 3. As I said before, computers don't generate random numbers, real random numbers. They are pseudo-random numbers. So if we use the same seed, we're going to get the same results. Let's do this in order to get the same results. And the seed, well, I have used the seed 1, 2, 3. So let's use this seed to get the same results. Now, we're going to generate, some data points, and these commands which appear here are just to generate this data set. We could spend some time trying to understand these commands there, but don't worry. I don't think it deserves a second of our attention. So if we take these commands and we run them, that's what we get. This is our data. This is our data. And this data has been generated randomly, and you should get the same results, exactly the same results. Exactly the same results. So what we see here are two clouds of points, one green and one red. These two clouds of points, we usually use the word cloud for these things, clouds of points, are not separable, are not perfectly separable. We can separate them even with curves. Well, linearly, of course, they are not separable. We can draw a line that separates them. But what I have generated, the numbers that I have generated here, are really two normal distributions. One of them is centered here at point 2, 2, is the average of the red one. Here we have the 2 and the 2, and this is the center of the red cloud. It's at point 2, 2, but of course, they're random numbers, so there is a variance. The center is here, but there is a variance. And then I have generated another cloud, the green one,
whose average is at 0.00. This is the real structure of what I have done. So we have two points. One is centered at 0.00, and the other one is centered at 0.22. So if we want to separate them, the real structure that we have, and of course this green cloud has some variation, and that's why it's spread. And this spread, this variance of this one and this one, makes that they overlap here in the middle. But really, the structure that we have here is that we have two things, one green and one red, and if we want to separate them, the best thing that we can do is to draw a line like this. This is the real structure, because we have one thing at 0.00, one thing at 0.22, and the variance is noise. And the real structure is that red is here and green is here. So if we want to separate red from green, we need a straight line like this. This is the structure, okay? Okay, let's see what happens if we use KNN. And if we change this K, this value for K, let's see what happens. And we are going to change the value for K. Let's close this. And first of all, as you know, we need to have a training sample and a test sample. So we're going to select out of the 1,000 points that we have there, which is called the global sample. The global sample is what we have just shown. We are going to select 750 points. And 750 points are going to be the training sample, and 250 points are going to be the test sample. That's what we do here. Okay? So out of these 1,000 points that we have here, we're going to select 750, and these are going to be the training sample, and 250 are going to be the test sample. So with these commands here, we select and plot the training sample, and we get this. We get this plot. Here we have and the same thing for the test sample. We're going to select from the 1,000 points, we're going to select 250 points, and this is going to be the test sample. As you see here, the test sample is much smaller, but they have been randomly selected, so we understand that this is a representative sample from the whole set, from the whole sample, and the training sample is also a representative sample. Okay? So what we have is a global sample, a test sample, and a training sample. We can move between graphs with this arrow that we have here. With this arrow, we can move to previous plots. So we have the global sample, the training sample, and the test sample. Okay? You see that? Perfect. That's what we have. And remember, the real structure is that we have something at 2.2 and something at, sorry, something at 2.2 and something at 0.0. And then we have some noise which makes the clouds overlap. But this is noise. Perfect. Well, this is the k nearest neighbors computation. And here I am using k equals 3. But I'm going to be more extreme. I'm going to change that. I'm going to change that to k equals 1, the extreme case, and see what happens. Well, more or less the commands that we have here. First of all, KNN is a function that we need to use to train a KNN. And this is the function that we need to use, KNN. And KNN is not part of the base of R. So we need to load a package. Remember about packages and so on? We talked about packages the first day. We need to load
a package which has been previously installed. This package is called class. So we need to require class. Require class means I want to use some commands that are not on the base part of R and which are included in this package. So we require class, and then we define that the train part is what we have in the training sample. We define that the test part is what we don't have in the training sample with this minus here. That means that it's the rest of it. And then we define which are the real classification from these points. Okay, don't worry. Let's use this and let's see what happens. That's what we get. What we get here is not very useful. We're not going to understand. Well, we see a sequence of zeros and ones. This is the classification that our KNN model makes for every point that we have in our training, sorry, in our sample, sorry, in our test sample. So this has been defined. This has been defined as a zero, a zero, a zero, a zero, and so on and so on and so on. But what we want to do is to see this compared with the real classification, and that's what we get here. This final part is what we are interested in, and that means that we had 104 and 20, so 124 zeros, and out of these 124 zeros, 104 have been correctly classified and 20 have been incorrectly classified. Okay, not bad. And we had 126 ones. Okay, and out of these 126 ones, 108 had been correctly classified, and 18 have been incorrectly classified. That's what we get here. Okay, not too bad, not too bad, because we had to classify this, and it seems like here there should be more mistakes, because here we have quite an overlap. So getting our model to classify with this error rate seems quite a good thing. But let's see it. Let's see what happens. Let's see what happens. Now we're going to see how our model, the one that we have obtained, classifies the training sample. Let's see what happens in the training sample. And you're going to see what overfitting means. Let's see. It's going to take a while, depending on your PC. But you should get something like this. You should get something like this. Let's zoom this. You should get something like this. This is a clear example of overfitting. Remember, the real thing, what really happens with these two clouds is that we have something here which is green at 2.2 and something here which was red but now is blue, just to avoid the problem with this background. So this is the red part, okay? Blues are now are the previous reds. That's what happens, that we have something at 0.0 and something at 2.2. So if we want to separate them, we need to draw a straight line like here. And we see that our classifier, our KNN classifier, sorry, with K equals 1, makes whatever is necessary to do in order to include the points where they have to be. For instance, we have here, and you should have on your computers, a special black area just special for these two green points which appear there. Do you see them? We have 2 points there, and then, boom, appears a black area to cover them, to classify them correctly. You see it? And then, for instance, what happens here with this, where is it? With this red area here. It's just a special area for this blue point, which is there. You see it? It's special for this point. So we are defining the shape of the frontier. It's incredibly wiggly. And why are we defining it like this? Because we want to adapt perfectly to the training sample. This is the training sample, don't forget this. Okay, so here we have our black area for this point, a black area for this one here, black area for these points over here. This thing that appears here just includes these points over here. So, and the same with blues. We have this area over here because we have some points over here. So it's incredible. It's overfitting the data. Now let's see what happens when we use the same frontier. We delete the training sample and we put here the test sample. And we are going to see what? That, for instance, this area here makes no sense at all, because here we are not going to have green points in the sample test. In the test sample. We're going to have blue points. So this area is going to be senseless. And for instance, this area here is not going to make sense, because this is just here because in the training sample we have this point. Okay, let's see what happens. Now, the same, we're going to draw the same thing, but instead of using these points, we're going to use just the sample test. I'm going to zoom this. And we see, of course, this red area that we had here now makes no sense at all, because here we have nothing. Why do we need this area here? It makes no sense. And this area here, and this here, why is that here? And this area here, and here, and here? Do you see this? These areas made sense for the training sample when we had some points there. But when new data appears, this is new data for KNN, because KNN has not seen this data before. Now new data appears, and KNN says, what's that? So this frontier, we have a frontier here that separates red, black from red, is too complex. It's too complex. It's very complex. But it's not only very complex, but too complex. Because when new data appears, it doesn't explain reality, which is that we have something here and something here. Why is that? Because we have used a value for K which is too low. We are looking just at one nearest neighbor. We are classifying a point according to the nearest point. Let's go to the other extreme now. What happens if we set K to be, for instance, 100? What's going to happen? In order to classify a point and decide if it's going to be red or it's going to be black, we're going to look at the 100 nearest neighbors. 100 is a lot. What's going to happen? Well, if we use 100, I don't know. But if we used 750, what will happen? Everything will be the same color, because we will look at every point. We will look at every point and we will see, and we'll say, how many red points do we have? How many green points do we have? Which is the majority? Green. Then everything is going to be black. Okay, so we are not going to do this. But let's see what happens when we increase the value for k. What's going to happen? Someone can tell what's going to happen.
There won't be those.
The frontier is not going to be so wiggly. It's going to be more a straight line. Because real structure is that we have a straight line to separate green from red. That's all. So let's increase the value for k and see what happens. For instance, if k equals 5, and then we use k equals 5 here for the test sample, k equals 5, we compute the k and n with the training sample, and we get this. We get this. As you see, well, it's quite wiggly, but not as curved as before. Now, the structure appears much more clearly. What we have is something there, which is red, and something here, sorry, something there, which is black, and something here, which is red. Okay? And if we increase the value for k, we are looking now at 5 nearest neighbors. If we increase the value for k, for instance, if we say k equals 21, for instance, ¿no le ha gustado? As you see, now the frontier is almost a straight line. And R is not K and N, this algorithm, this procedure is not trying to adjust to points like this blue point here. Well, we have a blue point here, but as I am looking at the 21 nearest neighbors, the majority of points over here are green. So I don't care. I have one blue point here, but as the majority here are green, then I'm going to classify this point as a black area. And the same thing happens here. Well, I have some green points here, but here the majority of points are blue. So this is going to be classified as a blue point, and I'm not going to devote one special black area for this point over here. So as we increase the value for k, the structure begins to appear, and if we get an even bigger number in the end, I don't know, if we, for instance, select this to be 101, I always use odd numbers. Let's look at the 100 nearest neighbors. It needs to compute a little bit more, so it's going to need more time. Yeah. Yeah, we are used to have instant results, but that's not reality. We need some time to process this data, and with this number we almost get what we should get, which is a straight line that separates greens from blues. You see this? So we are fitting with this value for k, we are fitting, we are not overfitting, we are not underfitting, we are fitting. When will we underfit? If we increased the value for k to 750 to the whole sample, then we will get a red background or a black background, which means nothing. But we need to find the right value for k. This is a very extreme example. But I think that you can understand that if the value for k is too low, overfitting. If the value for k is too big, underfitting. OK, questions about this? Yes, yes. The idea is two. The one I said before, you need to listen to the podcast. Yeah, the idea is let's adjust the KNN with the training sample. Okay, we know that if we follow the idea of trying to minimize the error classification rate in the training sample, the smaller the K, the better. Because if K equals 1, we're not going to have errors in the training sample. But if k is too low, then we're going to have a lot of errors in the test sample. So the approach should be using the value for k which minimizes the error rate, but not in the training sample, but in the test sample. Because KNN has not seen the data in the test sample. It had used the training sample, it has learned the frontier, and then we have used this frontier to classify the test sample. Okay? The frontier which has the lowest error rate with the test sample is the best one. So adjust with the training sample and test with the test sample and use the minimum error rate in the test sample as the criterion to decide which is the right value for k. That's a very good question.
So your decision in order to know the number of k, huh? Is depending on how you can see the curve or how can draw the curve that you can see.
No, no. I say it again. The decision for the value of k is here we make a decision based on the appearance of the frontier. That's not very orthodox. So what you should do is divide the sample in two parts, training and test. Don't look at this. Don't look at the test sample. Forget this part of the sample. And look just at the training sample. And take a value for k. Let's call it k1, the first value for k. And learn KNN. That is, see which is the frontier. Okay? And now, with this KNN number 1, let's use the test sample to compute the error rate. How many points, no, which proportion of the points in the test sample are not correctly classified with this KNN that we have learned? Okay, now, let's take a second value for k, k2. And with this second value for k, let's compute the second classifier, KNN2, which is going to define a different frontier. Now, use this KNN2 to compute the sample test error rate, which is going to be error rate number 2, and so on and so on and so on and so on. And you should compare all these error rates and choose the minimum. So in the end, you're going to select the value for k which minimizes the error rate for the test sample. Because if you decide to use the KNN, the value for k, which minimizes the error rate in the training sample, this is the same as what? As using k equals 1. So this is not a good approach. This is not a good approach. So the idea is always to choose the value of the parameter, we need to look at what happens here, not here, but here, at the test sample. More questions?
I don't get this.
you are always comparing the, your classification with the test sample, and then you don't need the training sample. Right? I mean, if the, the perfect value for K is depending on the test sample.
No, but it doesn't depend just on the test sample, because this error rate depends on the KNN you have learned, which is the frontier that you have learned. And the frontier that you have obtained depends on the training sample. So it's two steps. Don't look at this data here. Just use this data. With this data, you decide, you obtain one frontier. And this frontier has to be applied to the test sample. And in this test sample, which is data that the KNN has not seen before, is going to give you an error rate. That's a simulation of, well, OK, I'm learning something with the data I have. But what's going to happen when new data arrives? This is new data for the procedure. So this KNN that you have learned, this is a frontier. This frontier depends just on the training sample and doesn't depend on the test sample. Then you use this to compute this error rate here, because you want to simulate the idea of what happens if new data arrives. New data arrives, you compute the error rate for this new data, because you don't want a good classifier for the data you have. You want a good classifier for general data. That's why we follow this procedure. And of course, this error rate depends on the test sample, because you are computing it on the test sample, but it also depends on the training sample, because to compute this error rate, you are using this KNN, this frontier that you have learned with the training sample.
When you have only training sample, I heard that some people split the training sample and.
Yeah, yeah. That's the idea of bootstrapping. Bootstrapping and jackknife and these kind of procedures that are substitutes for this idea of dividing the sample into parts. Because as I said before, if you have a lot of data, then you don't care. If you have 10 million observations, then you can use some of these millions for training and some other of these millions for testing. But if you have 50 cases, then keeping some of them just for testing is very hard. So maybe you would decide in this situation, okay, let's use everything and then let's perform something of bootstrapping or jackknife to try to simulate this idea. The idea behind bootstrapping is to use the whole sample to train and then take off some of the observations from the sample and see how well it performs in this sample, which is new, between quotes, because it's not the training sample. It's a different sample because some of the observations have been removed. And then you remove some of them, then some of them, then some others, and then you average everything. This is bootstrapping, more or less. But if you have enough data, the good thing to do is divide this into training and test. If you don't, then, well, but these are second bests.
And how many different cases of K we need in order to get an accurate minimum error?
No. This is just.
Depends on the name of the points.
I will start with a reasonable number for K, and I will change it little by little, 10 by 10, and see what happens. It's very easy. You just have to change this, and even when you know how to code in R, you can create a loop that changes the value for K and computes everything and the error rate in the sample, and it's very easy to create here a loop that computes a lot of KNNs with a lot of different values. So you create this loop, go for a coffee,
or two or three, and then come back and okay, the best one is this.
There is one technique called convexity score matching, PSM. This is we have seen in the acromatrix study of Abrams. And they combine between this one, PSM.
I know nothing about PSM.
And this KNN. But I'm wondering, because first of all, we started by taking the logistic model and probability model. And then we moved to the KNN. And in the script, I haven't seen something that's related to the equations of robot model. So the relation between them, how is fitting them?
I know nothing about PSM. I know nothing. The problem with this field of data analysis is that it's so wide that everyone specializes in one area. And I have no idea about what you're talking about. Sorry. Any more questions? Okay, so that's what I wanted to tell you today. So see you on Monday.